promise you I won't be long this morning, but I'm really excited, and we had a great time yesterday morning with the leadership of this house. Thank you for the privilege you've afforded me to come and share. I'm really wrestling right now. I'm tussling right now because I got two messages in my head, which could be a problem for you all. Because if I got two messages in my head, then the one message would take about 45 minutes. But if it's two messages, it's going to take 90 minutes. And if you start to enjoy it and say amen and hallelujah, that can take us into 120 minutes. So I don't know what I don't know what's going to happen. But y'all going to take this journey with me just for a few minutes? How many of you got your Bibles or your iPhones or your iPads or wherever you carry the scripture or the text? Good, good. Whatever you got, go ahead and get it and open it up. And turn with me to a very interesting story. I want to draw your attention to 2 Samuel chapter number 9. This is one of my famous stories. I love this story, and I hope it encourages you today. Now, if you don't like it, just let Pastor know. He'll never, ever invite me back again. If you do like it, let them know that too, and we'll come back again. I don't know. If I do come back, I promise you I'll bring my wife back with me. She's not with me now. Matter of fact, what time is it? It's 11:02. We having our second service now, and she preached the first service at 8 o'clock, and she's going to preach the second service at 11 o'clock. Yeah, I wanted her to get a good baptism of how that feels. Yeah. That's another problem I'm having with you all right now. We have two services on Sunday morning. I normally do the 8 o'clock and 11 o'clock. And then on first Sundays, I meet with my leadership at 6 a.m. in the morning for 6 a.m. impartation. So that's three services for me. So I got it in me. So take your shoes off. We're going to be here a while. No, I'm only kidding. I'm only kidding. All the visitors are like, I knew we shouldn't have came this Sunday, Lord Jesus. I told you we shouldn't go. No. Okay, what did I say to turn to? 2 Samuel, chapter number 9. Just one verse of scripture, and then I'm going to go to Romans chapter 8, verse 11. Then I'm going to go to John chapter 10, verse 10, and see if I can pull it all together and bring this story. I want to introduce some people to you this morning that's in the text, and that's in my story this morning. So hang out there with me and take good notes and let the Lord bless you real good. 2 Samuel, chapter number 9, beginning at verse number 8. One verse in that chapter. There it is. Then he bowed himself. Are you there? You there? Okay. The Bible says, then he bowed himself and said, listen to what he says. What is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? I'll say it again. He says, this guy is talking. He says, who am I that you should look upon me? And this is how he describes himself. He says, I'm a dead dog. This very sad way to describe who he is. Okay, I'll come back to that in a minute. Romans chapter 8, verse 11 says, but if the spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief comes but to steal, to kill, destroy. Jesus said, I come that you might have life and that you may have it more abundantly. Before I introduce this guy that's speaking out of 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 8, I want to just kind of give you an understanding of how we come to moments where we say stuff like that. The man of God was singing, it's death and life and the power of the tongue. I'm really messed up with this conversation that this guy is having. But here's what I've understood. In all of our lives, there's a purpose that God reveals to us as we live our lives. Purpose is the original intent for the creation of anything that does exist. When you want to know the purpose of a thing, you don't ask the thing that exists, but you ask the creator, the one that made it. So purpose is vitally important in all of our lives in order for us to exist in the dimension that we believe or that we trust that God wants us to exist in. To every purpose, there is a plan. There's a plan that's connected to every purpose. Every purpose has a plan connected to it, because you cannot reveal your purpose. You can't unfold the purpose except you walk out the plan. To every plan, there is a pace. Everybody say a pace. There's a pace. There's a timing that is connected to the plan that reveals the purpose. You want to get to the purpose, you got to go through the plan, and you got to understand the timing. And pace, the pace of things doesn't always work always in your natural favor. That's why back in the old church, we used to say, he may not come when you want him, time, but he's right on time, time, pace, pace. We got to understand the pace of our lives. Some things happen in our lives because God ordained it to happen. Some things happen in our lives because we created it. Some things happen in our lives because it just happens in our lives. But when we understand the purpose by which God has designed us and called us to live, we understand that there's a plan connected to it. So it doesn't matter what time it is, it's still God's time, because it's God's plan and it's God's purpose. Along with God's purpose and God's plan and God's pace, there is always persons. I'm doing the P's right now. There are persons that God puts in your life to help you to understand the pace that God's connected to your life, so that you can understand the plan that God's connected to your life, that you can understand the purpose, the unfolding, the revealing of who you are and what you are supposed to do. God created you with a purpose, with a plan, with a pace, timing, with persons. We never get to where we are in and of ourselves, but God always puts people in our lives to help us to arrive at a place that he has designed for us to arrive at. No man is an island. Everybody needs somebody to get you to where you're getting ready to go. I would go as far as to say there's persons in your lives right now, in your life right now, who are very vital and very valuable to you. And if they were not there, you would not be able to go where you think you're going or where you believe you should go. So there's persons in our lives. There's a pace connected to our lives. There's a plan, and there's a purpose. Now, I just wanted y'all to, I kind of want to build that as a foundation, make that a foundation for where I want to go. Let's go back to that text one more time in 2 Samuel chapter number 9, verse number 8. This guy is having a conversation, and this is how he describes himself. He says, "Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I?" Oh, man, this is terrible. It's terrible to come to this conclusion where you describe yourself as not just a dog, but he says a dead. It's a terrible thing. Let me introduce the guy that's talking here. The guy that's talking here has a very unusual name, and he's an unusual person. He's had an unusual journey. Must be unusual, because he comes to this point in his life where he announces that he's a dead dog. His name is Mephibosheth. Everybody say Mephibosheth. And if you ever want to speak in tongues, you don't know sure how to, just say that five times real fast. You'll be there. No, I'm only kidding. I'm only kidding. Okay. Mephibosheth, 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 Mephibosheth. You got it. That's the Holy Ghost. No. Mephibosheth, Mephibosheth. This guy, his name is, what's his name? Mephibosheth is his name. And hey, what's up? All right. His name is Mephibosheth, and he concludes by saying, he concludes with, he's having, I'll tell you who he's having the conversation with in just a little while, but he concludes by saying, "Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I?" Now, let me just say this about his situation. It seems to me that this guy, and we just celebrated Easter Sunday morning, and last Sunday was great, and it was Resurrection Sunday morning. But when I look at the text, when I look at this guy's life, and I listen to what he says about himself, I can only conclude that he has come to a place in his life where he has lost every sense of possible resurrection. He seems to have found himself in a hopeless predicament. He's in his mind, in his heart, in his soul, he says he's a dead dog, which means there's no life in me. I'm done. So he kind of describes to us a person who has lost their sense of hope, their sense of resurrection. coming back to life again. That's a terrible place to be in, feeling that there is no hope for you, when there's no resurrection for you, when there's no coming back for you. That's a terrible place to be in. Resurrection is important. The reason why we had, last week we had Passover, we had Holy Week, it was to lead us toward resurrection. The Passover was necessary theologically, it was necessary philosophically, because it is resurrection that gives us a hope. It is resurrection that says to us that even though the Friday may come, the night may come, the darkness may come, but yet there is coming a resurrection. We're coming back. This guy seems to have lost that sense of coming back. He's lost that sense of coming back. Now the problem that I see in the text is that this guy has seemed to have, he's lost his way. Let me give you his background. His name is, what's his name? His name is Mephibosheth. And let me just give you his background. Let me tell you who he is. He is the son of Jonathan. He's the son of Jonathan. Who is Jonathan? Jonathan is the son of Saul. Saul, who is the king. Y'all like y'all. Y'all talking back to me. I like class participation. I like that. That's pretty good. So let's go over again. So this guy's name, what's his name again? Mephibosheth. His name is Mephibosheth, and he is the son of Jonathan. He's the son of who? Jonathan. Jonathan is the son of Saul, who is the king. Watch this. Saul is the king. Jonathan is the son of Saul, who is the king. Jonathan has a son. His name is Mephibosheth, who is the son of Jonathan. Jonathan is the son of Saul, who is the king. The king is Saul, who has a son by the name of Jonathan. Jonathan has a son by the name of Mephibosheth, and Mephibosheth is the son of Jonathan, which means he's the grandson of Saul, who is the king. And this is what he says about himself. Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I? His name is Mephibosheth. I know you heard this before, but just bear with me. His name is Mephibosheth. He's the son of Jonathan. Jonathan is the son of Saul, who is the king. Saul is the king. Saul, I'm sorry, just, it's my mind. It's me. Saul is the king. Jonathan is the son of the king. Mephibosheth is the grandson of Saul, who is the king. Oh, okay, just for a second. I have a son. My son's name is George Cornelius Seawright II. My son had a son, his first son, and his name is George Cornelius Seawright III. George Cornelius Seawright III is my grandson. I'm Pop-Pop. The thing about Pop-Pop is that my grandson can get whatever. The only reason why, he's only 4 years old right now. And the only reason why he doesn't have his own iPhone, because my wife won't let me give it to him. My son, on the other hand, is having problems now because he can't figure out and understand why is it that you would give him stuff, and even when he doesn't listen, you don't treat him like you treated me. I say to him, it's too bad, it's too bad. When I had you, I felt one way. When you had him, I felt another way. I thought I knew what love was all about, but when the third showed up, I'm done. And I warn you, don't have another one. Well, he did have another one. His name is Joshua Blaze Seawright. And because he's the grandson, Joshua Blaze Seawright can get whatever he wants. When Papa and Jima and Mimi shows up at the house in Orlando, when we show up, they come to life. Oh, yeah, they do. Oh, because they know that their help has come. They know that the blessings of Abraham and the blessings of their grandfather has showed up. That, I don't know why I'm talking like this, but I need to get back to my message. Let me get back to my, where my notes at? Where my notes? Where the notes at? The notes at? Let's look at the text again. The text describes to us this guy, Mephibosheth, who says, "Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I?" Let me get back. Let me go back to 2 Samuel chapter number 4, verse 4. It will show you. You can read it when you get home. What happened to him that caused him to find himself in this arena of life, where he's faced with death of himself, where he speaks death of himself. The story says that when his father and his grandfather went out to battle, the word came back from Jezreel that they were defeated. And Mephibosheth, when he was at 5 years of age, was placed in the hands of a caretaker. And the caretaker took care of him. And when the news came to the house, the caretaker got in a hurry, got in a rush. She was excited. And she picked him up. And the Bible says, and he fell and broke his feet. He broke his legs. He could not walk. He became he became disabled. Okay. Let me get my thoughts together. He became disabled, and let me pause just for a second, because that happens to a bunch of us. When we're placed in the hands of certain people, they don't always come through for us like we want them to come through. But here's our challenge. Here's our challenge. He's the grandson of Saul, who's the king. He's the son of Jonathan, who's in line, which makes him a prince who has been disabled. He's a prince who's become disabled. Now, I'm not an English major or anything like that. I went to school because my mama told me to go to school, and I went to college because I could play basketball. But last I checked about the English language, when it comes to words where you have, there's always in words that have a disc in front of it, there is a root word connected to it. Let me see if I can put it together. So he's a prince who now becomes disabled, which means he was able. But when the dis shows up, the dis negates, cancels out the root. Somebody's gonna get this in the morning when you wake up. The disc messes up his ableness. Touch your neighbor. I know I said it. Touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor you are able. You are able. And here's your challenge. You cannot allow one this moment cancel out the fact that you have been made by God to be able. I dare somebody to shout, yeah, I'm able. Yeah, I'm able. Yeah, yeah. I'm able. The disc. He's the prince on his way. And he goes through some of the things that some of us go through. And we let me just talk for a minute about the disc. There's words like, you know this word, disappointed. or disappointment. The dis messes up the appointment, but I come to tell somebody today, I come to remind somebody today, I don't care how many times you've been dissed, you still have an appointment by God, yeah? Oh, I dare you to give somebody a high five and say, I don't care about my diss, I still have an appointment, because the root word is appoint. You got to be careful. You got to be careful. You got to be careful when the dish shows up in the midst of your courage. And you become dis. But the bottom line is, the root word is, you still got. I wish I could find somebody who will shake themselves loose from some dis-suffering situations in your life and say, I still got courage. I still got courage. When the enemy comes in like a flood, I got some courage. I got the word of God. I still got some. I got some courage. I'm almost through. The displeased. There's the word disapproved. This, and then I like these two last words, disqualified. You are qualified. Some of y'all sitting here, and you didn't have enough education to be where you are, and they disqualified you, but God had another plan for you that says, well, I qualify you for this next level. While the world may disqualify you, I qualify you. This last one is a little interesting because it's not spelt the same way the other discs are spelled. But if you've been disapproved, you've been disqualified, you've been discouraged, you've been displaced, you've been dislocated, you've been dis, ultimately will move you into dysfunction. The dis moves you into dysfunction. Let me tell you, I'm going to get to the end of my story. I'm really going to be done in a minute. All right, I will. I certainly will. He becomes dysfunctional. He was dropped at the age of 5. So sometimes if we're not careful, those who drop us will make a determination in us, or it shapes us in how we believe in possibilities. If you've been dissed, if you've been dropped, if you've been let down, if you've been living in the realm of discouragement, it will shape you into either believing that God can do this miracle, or maybe he just won't. Maybe I just need to settle down and just be whatever it gonna be. I don't want to get too happy right now, but this guy, remember his name? Mephibosheth. He's messed up in his life because of the dis moments of his life. And not only does he have disappointments in his life, but when his daddy names him, who names their child Mephibosheth? So he's not only dis from the outside, he's dis from the inside. His name, the root of his name means scattered shame. It means two things, scattered shame and public embarrassment. So he's the grandson of the king. He's a prince in the making. But he has so many dis moments that he concludes for himself, my daddy named me shameful. Named me embarrassment. How do you get through what you think you're going through when your peers and your family members don't know how to handle you. I'm sorry, I just got excited just now. And I just got excited because I know where I'm going with this next thing. I'm gonna finish my story. He's so dis that he becomes, you gotta watch this, we gotta be careful of this. He's so dis and disappointed and discouraged and despondent, despair. Everything is so negative with him that he decides that he's going to relocate. He relocates because he's dislocated. In his dislocation, he relocates to a place where he doesn't belong. You got to be careful hanging around church folk who have been discouraged. They will always look for other discouraged people because they need discouraged people to co-sign their decision to walk out the door. I'll get back up here. You better stick to the notes. Don't mess with the people. Leave the people alone. Okay. You have to be careful for those who want you to co-sign their demise. Yeah, let me finish my story. So he relocates and he goes to this place called Lodibar. Terrible, terrible, terrible. Lodibar is a bad place to go. If you check out the history of Lodibar, it's the connection with Lot and his devilish folk and carrying on. Long story short, Lodibar is not the right place to be when you are the son of Jonathan and the grandson of Saul, who is the king. But because you're so dis, you dislocate yourself and you relocate to a place where you don't belong. I'm coming. The reason why he doesn't belong, and the problem with this is he hooks up with this family. There's a guy by the name of Mashiach. Mashiach is the daddy of this other crazy. Mashiach is messed up himself. So he allows the messed up Mephibosheth to come and live with him. You be careful while you're being dis that you don't hook up with other dis folk, because they will invite you into their house. And the bottom line is, I dare you to grab your neighbor and say, neighbor, you don't belong there. 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 I'm sorry, I get upset. You don't belong there. And what's even more devastating is Mashiach does not know who Mephibosheth is. He's the son of Jonathan. I'm sorry. He's the grandson of Saul, who's the king, which makes him a prince. And Mashiach doesn't have any idea who he is. Good Shatebe Kosha. You gotta be careful that you don't hang around with people who don't know who you are. Because if you hang around people who don't know who you are, when you get there, they will lock onto you and keep you right there in their Lodibar situation. But if you hang around people who can remember when you got hands laid on you, when the oil was running from you,
when the joy was ringing in your soul, when God called you, you didn't wait for somebody to call you, God called you. When you hang around people who know who you are, when you're in the wrong place, they'll push you out of that place. They won't lock you in, but they'll say, you don't belong here. I dare you to find somebody in your area and push them and say, you better get where you belong. You better be where you're supposed to be. You're not supposed to be in Lodibar. You are a prince.
I'm almost done. I'm almost done. let me just say it again, because it really struck a note right there. You can't keep hanging out in places where you don't belong. You want to be around people who know the value of your life. So when you get discouraged, they look at you in the face and say, "Come on out of there. What are you doing? Don't you live there? You can visit there, but you can't live there. When I'm disappointed, you can visit, but you can't live here. And you got to make sure you don't have no diss stuff in you, because if you do, you'll hold them in hostage. But I got to hurry. So Mephibosheth. You remember Mephibosheth, right? Who's the son of Jonathan, who's the grandson of Saul, who's the king, which makes Mephibosheth a prince. And he doesn't even know it. Because his understanding of who he is, because of his diss, brings him to a conclusion. He says, "Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog?" It's like, wait, I got ahead of myself. Because something brought him to this place where he describes who he is. He's in, Dr. Robinson, he's in Lodibar, where he doesn't belong. Let me introduce another guy to you who's important. This is very important. His name is David. Saul is off the scene, and David is now king. David has a moment of remembrance. He's in his kingdom. He's having a good time, telling people what to do and where to go. All of a sudden, he recalls his relationship with Jonathan. And I don't know what day it was. I don't know if it was a Monday or Tuesday, Wednesday or Friday. I don't know what day it was. But one day he wakes up and he says, "Wait a minute. Is there anyone left of the household of Jonathan that I, the king, may show kindness to?" I'm gonna help you in a minute. I forgot to tell you my subject. I do know better than that. I'll give it to you later. I'll give it to you at the end. So David says, "Who? Is anybody left of the household of Jonathan?" Saul's house, Jonathan's house, "that I may show kindness to." Let me introduce another guy to you. There's this guy that's hanging out with David. His name is Seba. Seba is hanging out with David around the throne. And Ziba gets wind of what David is asking. Ziba says, Yo, Dave, what's up, dude? Listen, check this out. There's a guy by the name of Mephibosheth who is located down in Lodibar. He's the grandson of Saul and the son of Jonathan. David says, "Go get him." I'm sorry. Y'all missed it. Y'all missed it. It went right over your head. David says, go get him. I'm sorry, I get excited. No, I didn't work out yesterday, so this is my workout this morning. David says, go get him. Go get him right now. Here's what I figured out. When you are, help me, Jesus. When you are supposed to be living in a resurrected place, and you are at a place, somebody ought to write this down. The king will come looking for you. I ain't got no saved sinners in the house. I ain't got no wayward folk who was outside of the safety of the blood of Jesus, but somehow you found your way. Okay, I'm almost done. Yeah. David says, go get him. I'm gonna need some help. They go down to Lodibar. This blesses me because in order for Jesus to get you, he had to throw down some stuff and go down. He could not go down in divinity. He had to come down in humanity to get you from where you were. I don't know if I can get anybody that will give God a big praise right now for coming after you, for finding a way to get you out of the muck and the mire that you were in, out of the mess you found yourself in. I don't know how you feel about that, but I once was lost in sin. But Jesus took me in. Don't make me sing right now. Now, I don't even sing anymore when I preach. I don't even sing anymore. I don't know what y'all making me do. Sit down. They go down to Lodibar to get Mephibosheth. They go to Lodibar. Ziba said, this way he is, David. He down in Lodibar. David says, y'all go get him. Bring him to me. I need a scarf, a big one. I need a big scarf. Help me preach. This is a nice one. My wife would like this. They go get Mephibosheth. Mm-hmm. I need a chair. Can I have a chair? They go get, y'all want me to do this down here? Up or down? Okay. They go get Mephibosheth. If you can remember, he ain't got no legs. So they pulling him into, and he's saying, no, then leave me where I'm at. I'm all right. Leave me there. No. Why y'all doing this? I don't want to go there. I don't belong there. I'm a mess. I'm not even whole. And they drag Mephibosheth to the king's table. They sit him. They put Mephibosheth at the table and give him a scarf.
And while he's sitting at the table, the story says that when he gets there, and David comes in the room, he looks at David and says, "Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I?" You see, the problem with him coming and sitting at the table is that it wasn't right. You could not bring a cripple to the king's table. It was out of order. But I'm so glad David said, "I ain't studying about no order right now. I need to show kindness." So Mephibosheth says, "I'm a dead dog," but he's sitting at the table. The thing that blesses me is he probably was sitting there, and he probably was pushed under the table where you could not see his broken feet, because those that were in the kingdom would judge him. Oosha. Oosha. Who did you put in place in this church? Who did you let become a pastor or a minister? Who did you let become an usher? Who did you let become a trustee? Who did you let, and all of y'all that got an assignment here, you are a mess. And the only reason why you can be in the position you're in is because the Lord covered you. You ain't here because you've been that good. You ain't here because you've been that smart. You're here only because he... I dare somebody to give God praise for covering you. Yeah. If your neighbor knew the mess you were in, they probably wouldn't sit next to you. But help me, church. Somebody say, "Oh, thank you, Jesus, for covering my life." I'm done. I'm closing. Y'all checks will be in the mail. Thank you for helping me. I close because my time is up. I close on this. David says, it's all right, because Mephibosheth is saying, "I don't belong here. I'm a dead dog." But David has a conversation with him. He says, "Oh, I know you in a mess. I know you don't qualify. I know you don't meet the standards to be around the throne. I know all of that." He said, "But let me make something perfectly clear to you, Mephibosheth. You ain't here because of your name. You are here because of who you connected to. I'm showing you kindness, not because of anything that you have done to merit this. But when I think about Saul and the relationship that I've had with your daddy, this is the reason." God will put persons in your life. God will connect you to a pace, a timing, and it will all work out for your good, but it ain't got none. Some of your blessings that y'all get in this dream life center is because of who you connected to. So my subject this morning is stay connected. Because you never know when you are this, where you'll find yourself in the wrong place. But because of your connection, you don't sell the Dream Life Center for short. You don't sell yourself short. You are connected to the right place. You're connected to the right persons. You're connected at the right time. And if you can just hold on a little while longer, the king will come looking for you to get you more blessings, to get you a greater miracle, to get you a bigger breakthrough, to put you in the realm of bigness in this year. This year is going to be the biggest year you ever had in your life. And the reason is because of who you are connected. Let me shut this down for real. I have a position in the city of New Brunswick, and my position is a good position. When I started the church in 1991, the mayor of the city became the mayor the same year that I became the pastor of Abundant Life Family Worship Church, and we've been friends ever since.
It is at his request that I became one of the police chaplains in the city of New Brunswick. Now, what does that do for my saints? Well, let me tell you something. My saints, sometimes I got to lay hands on them and pray for them to tell them to calm down. Because they think they can go over the speed limit down the streets of New Brunswick. And because they know who they connected to, all they have to do is mention my name. And the officers who I pray for, who I counsel, will say, all is forgiven. I had a young man in my church. He was one of a minister. He decided he didn't want to minister no more. And he got caught up in stuff. And I ain't going to tell you his whole bit, all his business. But he got caught up in stuff. And they took him to jail. When he got to jail, I'm sorry, I need to calm down. Ain't no need me getting upset about this. Ain't no need me getting upset about it. But when he got to jail, he didn't call his daddy. He didn't call his mama. He didn't call his uncle. Neither did he call his auntie. You know who he called? He didn't call Ghostbusters. He called George Cornelius Seawright, Bishop of Abundant Life Family Worship Church in the city of New Brunswick. He called me and said, can you come and help me? Can you get me out of here? Of course, I had some thoughts. I said, maybe, based on what you did, maybe you should stay there. But I said, no, let mercy reign in this moment. I got out of my bed and got dressed. Now, you know this had to be God. And I got in my car, kissed my wife and said, I'll be back. Went down to the station, went through the door. They saw me coming. They said, oh, here comes the Reverend. Reverend, how can we help you? I got a son in here and I need to get him out. What did he do? Well, not only could I get him out, but I had to pay to get him out. So his connection was not with something that was busted, broke, and disgusted. He had the right, you got to know your right connection. I said, what does he owe? I'll pay what he owe and walked him out of there. And he's loving me like he never loved me before. From that day forward, everything has been all right. And that's all because of who he is connected. Oh, no. I ain't boasting. I ain't proud. No, I'm just clear on my position. And if you're clear on your position as a leader, then those that are following you ought to be clear on their position as a follower. And if you stay close enough, if you stay really connected, when it's time, you see, the oil flows from the same anointing will double up when it gets to you. But the key to this thing is that you got to stay. If I was a good preacher, I would go down the list of connections and I would sing and try to get you all up. But I'm tired. And I believe I've told you the story. The point, stay connected, y'all. Where Dream Life is going, you're going to need this connection. Don't allow this moments in your life to determine the direction for your life. There's a route. There's an appointment. There's courage. There's sound and whole doctrine here, which is the foundation of your real connection. I want to repeat this. When you're supposed to be in a resurrected place and you're out of place, the King will come looking for you. This morning, it's still morning. The King has come looking for somebody in this room. Here's another thing I've understood about this whole story here, is that when God promised to bless something, it doesn't matter where it is, he will fulfill his promise. God is not a God that he should lie. If he said it, he'll do it. If he spoke it, he'd bring it to pass. So if you're here in this moment right now, I don't know who you are. I don't know where you come from. I don't know what you've been through. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what the boss man told you. I don't know what your parents told you. I don't know what your husband told you. I don't know what your wife told you. I don't know what your kids said about you. I don't know But if you have experienced a dis moment, and that dis moment is causing you to think in the opposite direction of the call of God in your life, of the presence of Jesus in your life, I want to pray for you. If that's you, just stand up on your feet. You got dis moments, dis stuff going on. Dis, that's it. That's right. It may not be everybody, and it's probably not everybody, but just a few people. You got a dis going on. Yeah. You may be sitting here, and you have forgotten that you are a king's kid. That dis is so serious, and this is not game. We're not playing games right now. You are discouraged. People have disappointed you. And you're trying to figure out, what am I going to do? What should I do? Where do I go now? What am I going to do with myself? I want to pray for you this morning. And then I'm going to believe that you're going to realize, you're going to recognize that you are a prince. And if you've relocated to a lowly place, you know, you when you get up in the morning, you don't even want to cut the lights on. A low place, a dark place. I'm calling you out of that dark place this morning. Because of the dis moments in my life. And if you're here and you're saying, well, I don't want everybody to know that I'm functioning now. I'm a little dysfunctional right now. I'm not really clear in what I'm supposed to do. I'm not clear in where I'm supposed to be. Not clear in what I'm supposed to. And you feel embarrassed. I don't want nobody to know that. You got to get through that. You don't even have more time. You don't have no time for that. I want to pray for you this morning. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? I'm going to do what I promised to do. Father in heaven, I thank you for these incredible people. These people that you have called and laid your hands upon and chosen them. You chose them to be here in this moment because you had something so incredible for their lives. And you didn't want them to miss what you were going to do in their lives because of dis moments, discouragement, disappointment. Disconnected. Today, Lord, I pray that you will reconnect, that you will appoint again, that you will put courage in them again, that they will rise above this negative prefix that only the enemy has put before them. Pray, oh God, that they will shake themselves loose. And if they're in the wrong place, Lord, that you will rescue them. Cause them to find themselves in the right place. By your hand, God, I pray in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for coming after them. I thank you for allowing them to sit in here and to know that you are coming after them right now, that they're so valuable to life itself that you would take this time to come after them. That you would take this time to call them up. Take this time to stand them up and take this time to bring restoration. And resurrection and hope back again. Through the tears, Lord, bring hope. Through the pain and through the agony, bring resurrection, bring life again. We speak life unto you in the name of Jesus. And the same spirit that raises Jesus from the dead, it now dwells in your mortal bodies. And it quickens you and makes you alive. You will come back alive. You will dream again. You will see visions again. You will know that you can be what God has created you to be and do what he has called you to do. You will survive. You will survive. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you're standing, I'm going to ask you to remain standing. And then I'm going to ask the whole congregation to stand on your feet. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Would you do me a favor? If there's someone in your area and the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to them now, and they're not saved, they have not given their heart to Jesus. They decided that, I don't know if I really want to do this or not. But based on the word of God today, they hear that the Lord has come after them. He's seeking. He's been looking for you. He's been waiting for you. And I don't want to let this moment go by without you having the opportunity to give your heart to Jesus this morning. If you're here, you're saying, Pastor George, listen, listen, pray for me, man. I need you to pray for my soul for salvation. I'm not saved, but I want to be saved. I'm not saved, but I believe what you said is right, that the Lord's looking for me and he has come after me. And the reason why the bullet didn't kill me, the reason why the car accident didn't kill me is because God was looking for me. He had a plan for me. The reason why the divorce didn't take me out is because God had a plan for me. The reason why when they fired me from the job and I didn't lose my mind is because Jesus was looking for me. Would you come to him today? Would you give him your heart today?